Hey everybody, Carrie Clark here with Speech and Language Kids and the SLP Solution. And today we are talking about how to help a child who is stimming. Now, stimming is a shortened term for self-stimulatory behaviors. And these are behaviors that help a child regulate their sensory system when something's out of whack. So this might be hand flapping, it might be rocking, it might be banging. There's a lot of different ways that stimming can look. And a lot of times we'll see this in autistic children, but we will also sometimes see this in children with other sensory problems or even children without sensory problems. As an adult, I also stim, but mine tend to be shaking my foot, or I will get up and get a drink of water when I'm getting restless. So it's any way to regulate your sensory system. Now, our children who are stimming need that sensory input. For whatever reason, they need some extra something to help them regulate. But sometimes those stimming behaviors can become harmful or disruptive to the child. Okay, so I am going to talk specifically today about how we can help those children if the stimming does become harmful or interferes with their life in such a way that they would like help with it. Okay. I have received negative feedback before because people thought I was trying to say that we should stop all stimming. And that is not what I'm saying at all. I am saying that children need this input, but if it becomes a problem, then there are ways we can help them meet their needs in a less harmful or less disruptive way. But if a child is just stimming and it's not hurting anyone, then that's okay. We can let them have that and we can let them do that. I am not saying stop all stimming. So I just want to make that clear before we move forward. This is specifically for those harming or disrupting behaviors. Okay, so we have 4 steps for how to break down helping a child with stimming that is a problem. So the first one would be make sure you're working with an occupational therapist. I am giving this advice particularly to speech language pathologists because that is my profession. But I understand that parents will be seeing this information as well. And this is good to understand this process. But both parents and speech language pathologists should really get an occupational therapist on board for this because this is at heart a sensory problem. And sensory processing goes to our occupational therapists. But here's where speech comes in. Because behavior is communication. A behavior is communicating something to us, even if it's not through words. So we can help with that communication piece and that emotional regulation piece, which also falls in our domain. So first step, get an occupational therapist on board. Do this together. Work through this process together. The second step then is to identify what that behavior is communicating. Okay, so you're going to look at the stimming behavior. You're going to look at when it happens, what happens right before, during, and after the stimming behavior. That can give you some clues about why it's happening and what it might be communicating. So let's say the child starts biting themselves right before a certain activity. It seems like this biting behavior always happens when we're trying to transition into circle time or whatever it is. So then we might say, okay, maybe this behavior is them trying to regulate because they're not prepared for what's happening next. Or maybe it always occurs when they get frustrated. So we can look and see what seem to be the triggers for the behavior and then what sensory need that might be filling. And again, we can work with our occupational therapist on that. So once we've identified what we feel like that behavior is communicating, then step 3 is to try some replacement behaviors. So for our domain, we are really looking at, is there another way to communicate that need that might be more effective or less harmful or less disruptive if it's an older child who is saying, you know, I have this need, I don't know why I do this, but it bothers me that people see it and they don't understand, or whatever it is that the reason is for that child. So we're gonna try some different replacement behaviors. And from our perspective, we wanna make those communication. The occupational therapists will have some great sensory ones. So if we identify, you know, this is because this child hasn't had enough movement today, then the occupational therapist will have ideas for how to get more movement in. But let's say, for example, we notice that the child is having self-harming stimming behaviors when they get frustrated with what someone else is doing. Okay, so we can bring in a stop picture and show them that if they can say or point to stop, then we can help them get that other person to stop so that they don't get so amped up that they feel the need to self-harm. Okay, so that's how we're looking at this, is if they are communicating something to us through those stimming behaviors, how can we help them communicate it verbally so that we can get that need met quicker or more effectively? So we can try some different replacement behaviors. And then step four then is to be practicing communicating that need. So we are helping them communicate that need in their daily life. So, oh, I see them starting to engage in that stimming behavior. So we say, do you need to say stop? Do you want to say stop to that friend? And we can help facilitate that. Now, this is just one example. There's a lot of different ways that we can help people communicate different needs and regulate and ask for sensory breaks and all the different things that go into this. So it's more than just what I can fit in a 7-minute video, but I wanted to help you understand the framework is there if it is a stimming behavior that needs to be stopped because it is harmful or because the child wants to change it to something less disruptive. Okay, I think I hit all the highlights there. If you have more questions, head on over to speechandlanguagekids.com. We have a full blog post article where we go through this, and there's a workbook that you can kind of work through trying to figure out what some of those behaviors are communicating, and some sample replacement behaviors. So if you need any of that, of course, head over to speechandlanguagekids.com, and I'd be happy to answer questions in the comments as well if you'd like to comment in below this video. All right, thanks so much. Have a wonderful day.